any sort of that on that, but obviously we were having quite intense discussions. Just to welcome, and before we go live, I need to say this message, which is a Knowsley Council message. Colleagues, before this morning's meeting commences, I wanted to remind you all that this is a public meeting. Whilst we may not be able to see members of the public in the room, they may be watching this meeting live or the recording that is made by, available by Knowsley Council's public iPort. In light of this, can I remind all members of their data protection responsibilities and ask that you ensure that during the meeting you do not share any personal or private information that you may have been shared with by your constituents. Having said that, good morning, we do have some public attending today. Lindsay, can you go live, please? Thank you. All right, so we go back to that and we welcome again. I would like to welcome everyone to the meeting of the Peace and Crime Panel, including the Commissioner and her team, and any members of the public present or watching the live stream at home. Do we have any apologies, please?
We have apologies from Councillor Pavlovini and Councillor Sherry.
That's great, thank you. Our first item is the minutes of the last meeting. And any questions about the accuracy of the minutes? They're not really here to be taken up soon.
Chair, thank you. Just to record, I wasn't here at the last meeting. I think the record has been in the so that would just be elected. Thank you.
That's a significant typo.
So, Chair, subject to that amendment.
Can we accept that these are a true reflection and are an accurate record of our meeting? Thank you, everybody. Item two, declarations of interest. I don't know if anything submitted, Louise.
around tax
hazard behaviour, there's some detail in there on some work now around community engagement. There's some updates in there around our independent custody visitors. So this is these are individuals who go and visit custody and check on the welfare of those who are detained in custody. And so there's some details around the numbers and things around that. And then there's also an update on modern slavery. So I don't know if Jeannie, do you want to just update on that?
I know most of the information is in the papers anyway, but just very briefly to summarise, we have been meeting as a reform network from early in the year. After my appointment, that meeting's really well attended. There are usually between 20 and 30 partners there with a wide variety of agencies. The meetings have been split into two parts. The first was formulating the new modern slavery strategy. That will include key performance indicators and how we will measure success in the future. That has been very much co-produced with the partners around the table. And we did that so that everybody had ownership, so it wasn't specifically limited to one area, but it spanned as many areas as possible. That's now been completed, and the Commissioner held a consultation event where people were asked to give their views on the draft strategy. That's gone out to consultation, and we're hoping to launch the completed strategy at the network in January.
Have a few questions, Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Just a few questions, really. Settlement of let's see. What's the general trend around the areas in Merseyside itself? Is it up and down? I noticed that the operation value is 26% reduction.
Mm.
What's the general trend? And is it
so generally speaking, we are seeing a downward trend around attitude behaviour, and certainly that's what we've seen when we scrutinised at the last meeting. Sometimes I think when I go out and speak to communities, people will say, well, that's not, that doesn't feel like it's going down, it still feels like a very present issue. And so one of the things when we look at the statistics is that sometimes I think that what we might call antisocial behaviour, the police are actually criming, which they should be. And so while I think antisocial behaviour statistics themselves might be dropping, it's because they are better at criming those issues that are going on, such as criminal damage, whether it's graffiti or things like that. So actually, as a picture, just looking at ASB, we are seeing a positive trend across the region, and particularly in some of those key hotspot areas where we've been doing some targeted work. And as you say, I think particularly over the banner period, we've seen a reduction there as well. So we are seeing a positive narrative, but I'm always mindful that there might be other areas that we're seeing an increase in because we're just better at criming it, so we're trying to look at it as the whole.
Yeah, thanks. Is there any areas that you work with that police are struggling to get on top of it?
Not off the top of my head. I think we try, the work we do with the walkabouts and things is very much driven, where councillors or local residents are flagging that there are particular issues. We will then go and do that walkabout and make sure they've got the right response from the police, they've got the right resources, they've got, any kind of proactive diversion activity that needs to go on. So I think we try and respond quite quickly where people are highlighting areas as a problem. So I'm not aware of anything in particular that would be worth flagging.
Just to add to that, I know there's lots of great work going on in the city centre, certainly in terms of nighttime economy, where the police have got specific funding, group funding, and the results and the outcomes from that are very successful. But it is a hotspot approach in terms of where those hotspot areas are, and we're hoping that with being advised by the government that effectively we'll get some more funding in terms of hotspot policing, which will come directly to the Commissioner.
Just talking about funding, how do you evaluate the effectiveness of the new water bits? Can you see a rise or drop, or how do you manage that?
It depends on the different funding streams, so different projects, depending on where the funding has come from, or have different requirements of that. We do try and evaluate it. We have conversations with our community safety partnerships quite regularly to see what the impact is, and obviously data will be a part of that. There's an antisocial behaviour survey that's going to be going out shortly that I think actually the Home Office are leading on, but we'll be getting some of the data around that to get a sense of how people feel in their area and whether they feel antisocial behaviour is still an issue or not. So we try and look at a whole range of things to keep a sense of whether it's working or not.
Thank you.
unfortunately I was unable to attend the councillor conference, but I'm just wondering how you felt it went. Was it successful, well attended, and other plans for any more of those events in the future?
Yes, definitely. I think there is often a tendency to be kind of, the police like to impart lots of information to colleagues, and so there's always a challenge around trying to keep those things concise. Having said that, I think the feedback was that it was very useful information, and probably a lot of information that councillors weren't seeing before. So actually the feedback we had from people who were there was very positive, which was really good. And actually I think probably what we maybe do in future ones is just make sure we've got a bit more time to really promote that discussion, you know, so it's a two-way kind of dialogue. There was an opportunity to have conversations with the local policing inspectors and sergeants, just so that actually local councillors know who their local team are, and they can have that direct conversation. So I think that's quite positive as well. So yes, we are looking to do another one, possibly in the summer, probably after May. We'll look to do another one and potentially focus on another key theme. So we focused on antisocial behaviour and organised crime at the last one, but I think we might focus on something around violence women and girls, which is a topic that council had expressed an interest in, but very open to suggestions if there's other subjects that council would like to talk about. Mm-hmm.
Just add that several of us were in attendance and we thought it was great. Because we've had meetings at Mather Avenue where we've been given information as panel members, I think it was really useful for the broader council authorities to have similar information and to understand the scope and how many issues there are and the areas that are covered. And I think we were welcomed, and I think it was a very nice morning. Thank you. Tony?
Yes, thank you. I attended the conference and it was great to meet the senior members of the Wirral Police Force, covering Rockferry Ward in particular. One of the things which I took up the opportunity there to talk about antisocial behaviour, having spoken to the local police previously, and it was good to hear about the cooperation that there is with the Wirral Council on our antisocial behaviour member of staff. But one of the conundrums that we have is, I'll give you a small example of, in the Wilton Road area, there's a stretch of ground, only about 10 yards wide or so, where lots of stuff is dumped. It's not on the council's land, and so they will remove it. And the number of times that furniture has been satellites and what have you, and I've recently tried to get all agencies involved in terms of the council's antisocial behaviour, the local police, and the waste disposal folk and things like that. But and hopefully the results are there for you to be able to ensure that the local police family are able to help with that. And the design of crime person also is involved in that as well,
yeah,
in terms of trying to prevent any potential that fires have gone off at 4:30 in the morning recently, for example. And so, you know, policing, patrolling, even at that time of night, is still necessary to ensure the safety of communities.
I'm happy to take that away and make sure that you're getting the support from another policing from that perspective, and obviously from fire and other partners, because it's, I think that what you're describing is not an unusual situation where we get these pockets of activity, and we very much need that kind of problem-solving approach. So that's an example of one where, you know, if councillors felt they maybe weren't getting the right response from other partners, I would try and do a bit of a walk about, look at the scene, try and make sure that we're thinking about every tool that we've got to try and tackle some of the issues. So I'm very happy to take that one away. We can have a look at it afterwards, if that's right.
Thank you.
necessarily criminalise young people and actually try and reduce the behaviour, but it is on our plan to try and look at what the approach to young people would be. So I think we're at much of our time scales for that. But
yeah, there was a bit of reluctance by youth justice sites as well in terms of because obviously they focus on that age group, and so we took that approach that was going to be a phased approach. The next phase would be 16-18, but obviously then look at the wider approach going forward. But there was that reluctance and confidence by youth justice sites as well that we basically that they deal with that age range rather than just being a part of this plan.
I mean, the honest answer is it just takes time. It's capacity. We were given the money. The money was confirmed. I think in the summer, and we were basically told kind of we wanted it ready in a month or so. So I'll be honest. I think there's been some real challenges around trying to get the project up and running as fast as possibly the department for DLUC communities would have wanted us to. I will say, I think other than one other police area down in the south, we are probably doing the best in the country in terms of the area that's got the pilot that's got the most people running through it. So my understanding is there are some areas that haven't even launched their pilot yet because they've taken such a long time to put the provision in place. So although we're not quite hitting that 48-hour target, I think we are seeing some really positive results of those individuals who are involved in it. And actually, crucially, when you speak to individuals who have then done the reparative work, you know, they themselves are saying, actually, this was a really good opportunity because I've made amends, I've kind of thought about my behaviour, and now I'm getting access to support that I probably wasn't before. So I think the feedback is really positive. So we are going to aim for the 48 hours, but I think I'd rather get it right and get the right outcomes, which is beneficial for everybody, rather than trying to rush it, and then you don't necessarily get a positive outcome at the end of it, if that makes sense.
Thank you. Jennifer, then Peter.
Back to the Saint Streets funding, I was particularly interested in at what was the 10 million the course of council project to reduce crime against sex workers. So I've always been really pleased that Merseyside specifically recorded those crimes. I think it's really important. So I just wondered whether that recording was informing where the project was, whether that's coming from the community, and how that relationship is, because I would imagine that there's a good trust because of the focus on it, but I'm interested in how that relationship is and whether the forces are learning from that good work.
It's a good question, and yes, I think I'm really grateful actually for myself, because I took that decision many years ago now to record crimes against sex workers as a hate crime, because they're very much targeted and they're known in that way. I think the Shield Road area is a long-standing issue that has been issued with for a while now. There's been lots of work from all different agencies to try and intervene and try and tackle some of it. It's trying to get the balance to make sure we recognise those people who are particularly vulnerable and those who are facing kind of, you know, abuse and violence and how we kind of support them, but also recognise that the activity that is going on is obviously hugely disruptive to the community and, you know, is largely very pleasant for people in terms of litter and rubbish and things. So I think this project is hopefully going to try and tackle it from both sides in terms of intervention with those individuals who are in the area, but crucially trying to do things around lighting and CCTV to just make the area feel safer and allow them to try and tackle some of those kind of real perennial issues around you know, curb calling and things like that. So there is a really strong relationship, and it's something the community I think have been calling out for a long time. So I was really glad that we got the funding for this one actually, because I think it has been something that's been needed.
Peter?
Thanks, Jen. Commissioner. Can I ask a few questions on 4.5.1, the ASB case review?
Yes.
They're quite interesting case reviews, aren't they? Because it's something that the government brought in, and exactly how effective it would be in terms 2021, and then 32 last year, 2022. So there is no incremental rise. Wigan, smaller area, they seem to just have a figure for 2022, 23, and they've got 5. But from what I can tell, you know, Liverpool is not just a bit isolated. Merseyside 1 year, going back over the years, it seems to be very few numbers. Is there a ready explanation for that?
I think my assessment of it would be a couple of things. One, I think there is a positive suggestion around the fact that actually the local authorities are relatively good at responding to concerns around ASB, and actually that people have felt that they haven't needed to get the case reviewed because they've had a satisfactory response. So there will be an element of that. I think probably the larger point is the awareness of it. So one of the things that we have been looking at is how we can really, and part of the reason for changing the name from community trigger to ASB case review, is to just try and really highlight to the public that this is an option for them. So I think we recognise that, I think a lot of the public aren't aware that they can, if they're unhappy with the response they've had from the local authority, that there is an option for my office to review what that response was. So I think a big part of our plans moving forward are around how do we raise awareness of that and make sure the public are aware that this is an option available to them.
Yeah, it's difficult to know, isn't it? Because, as you say, one explanation is a good news explanation, and the ASP has been tackled successfully and effectively in the area, so there's no need for people to take this option.
Yeah.
But on the other side of the coin, you know, I suspect some public events, and that's just, you know, I know that's been a campaign by yourselves and by yourself in the Merseyside Police. Do you think that there are lessons maybe to look to other areas to see what they're doing in terms of raising public awareness of this, of the mechanism?
I mean, it's certainly something we can look at. I think our my ASB lead in the office has come from a local authority, and so we've got a lot of experience of that side of it. So she's very well kind of versed on it. So I think, and I'm sure she's linked in with other colleagues across the country, so I'm sure she'll be looking about already. But yes, yeah, certainly it's something we'll kind of factor in.
No, she's going to add that there was an awareness week that was going on in July,
yeah,
but those figures are kept by the authorities, not by the Police and Crime Commissioner.
Oh,
so, yeah, because effectively, as I think as the Commissioner said, if members of the public are happy with the way that's been dealt with, then it doesn't necessarily come to our awareness anyway.
Yeah.
But we will still work with the local authorities and partners to raise awareness that there's an opportunity to have that review as well.
Yeah,
because
I think
they
found in the City Council website, it wasn't really prominent, but I mean, again, the figures are quite low, all you know, single figures. 2018, I think it's 2 cases, none in 2019, 20, 2021, 1 case, 2022, no cases, and as you report in the case, there's just the 1 so far for this year. But it's the duty is with the local authority rather than yourselves or the police.
And I suppose just to add as well, I'd be grateful, I think, as local councillors, and we do try and get these messages out, but obviously, you know, if you are aware that residents are coming to you with ASB and you feel they're not getting good response, you know, please do help us spread that message that actually if they want to look at it, we have the opportunity to do that. So as councillors, if you have, it'd be great if you can share that message as well.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Commissioner. And I think that is actually a good piece of advice that we can share that in other arenas, because often with ASB, residents don't feel it's getting responded to quickly enough, and it can drag on, and there is recourse there if they wish to have it. Any other questions on item 3A? No? In that case, can we just call for? Oh, Jennifer, sorry. Well,
sorry, thanks, Chair. It wasn't really a question as much as just welcoming the news with modern slavery. And again, that's another thing we can all just work, raise awareness on, because I think that it covers such a broad thing, a broad range of things, doesn't it? And it's not just us that need to be aware of it, it's us getting a message from the people to know what to report and what to look for. Because I think once you start to do training in this area, it really opens your eyes, isn't it? So,
yeah.
Just like, thank you for the work. We're looking forward to seeing.
So the main focus around that is my scrutiny of what